very shortly. Thank you very much.
Good morning. Am I audible, please?
Yes, you are audible, sir.
Yes, sir. Sir, we are going to start the session within few minutes. We are waiting for a couple of speakers to join. So bear us with that.
So, good morning, everyone. My name is Ajay Dhyani. I'm from CII. And on my personal behalf, I would like to welcome you all at this inaugural session of the virtual conference on artificial intelligence. I would like to introduce our eminent dignitaries of the inaugural session this morning. We have with us Dr. Rajendra Kumar, Additional Secretary. He will be joining in any moment of time. We have Lieutenant General Dr. Rajesh Pant, National Cyber Security Coordinator, Government of India. We have Mr. Prateek Garg, who is the Chairman of the AI Regional Committee on Artificial Intelligence, and he is the Managing Director of Progressive Infotech. We have Mr. Vinod Sood, Co-Chairman, CII Regional Committee on Artificial Intelligence, and he is the Managing Director of Youth Systeem. Mr. Jagdish Mitra from Mahindra, he'll be joining us shortly. We also have Mr. Nitin Agarwal, partner Deloitte. Deloitte is a knowledge partner for this event. So ladies and gentlemen, without taking much of the time, I would request Mr. Prateek Garg to moderate the inaugural session. Over to you, Mr. Garg. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Ajay, Dhyani, for the introduction. Am I audible to?
Yes, Richard.
All right, great. So very good morning to all of you. Lieutenant General Rajesh Pant, who is the National Cybersecurity Coordinator for Government of India. Perhaps the center of all that is happening now. We're waiting for Dr. Rajendra Kumar, Additional Secretary, Ministry of Electronics and IT, Government of India, to join us for this session. Mr. Jagdish Mitra, I think he should also be joining. Chief Strategy Officer at Tech Mahindra. My co-chair, Mr. Vinod Sood. Hi, Vinod. On the CII Regional Committee of CII on AI, and Vinod, as you would know, is the Managing Director of Youth Systeem in India. From partners Deloitte India, who are our knowledge partners for this year, the CII as far as artificial intelligence is concerned. So on behalf of CII and my own behalf, I am welcoming all of you and all the guests that have taken time out, and I can see about we have about 120 delegates for this virtual conference. So thank you everyone for the time that you're taking today, this morning, to be attending this CII virtual conference on AI. The topic is demystifying responsible AI. And COVID times, I think, has brought AI into a very different perspective. So ladies and gentlemen, whether we realize it or not, AI is all around us and playing a very active role in our daily lives. In fact, as the world is grappling with COVID-19, every bit of technology innovation, ingenuity, and is being harnessed to fight this pandemic. And all of us on a daily basis are consuming it. Artificial intelligence and machine learning are playing a key role in better understanding and address the COVID-19 crisis. Machine learning technology is enabling computers to mimic human intelligence and ingest large volumes of data to quickly identify patterns and insights and strategies, therefore, how to deal with the pandemic. AI has been successfully applied to societal changes, societal challenges, in fact, and has shown a great deal of potential to provide tremendous social well-being. At the same time, AI is not just improving lives. In some cases, it is also saving lives. There are many organizations today who are implementing and leveraging AI and machine learning to improve healthcare, education, agriculture, and infrastructure systems. Our vision, therefore, should be to develop AI ecosystem in India and effectively engage with all the stakeholders towards benefiting the citizens and a holistic development of our nation. And as our Prime Minister has given us the narrative of Atmanirbhar Bharat. As we all know, that with more power comes more responsibility. As we get into a world where AI agents surround us more than ever before, industry and researchers have started to lay broad contours of rules and principles of responsibility that these AI machines should exhibit. That brings us to this virtual conference, the topic of today, demystifying responsible AI. So responsible AI is not about building and using AI machines responsibly, but with the focus on core tenets like fairness, accountability, inclusiveness, ethics, and other traits that a responsible human race should stand for. We will explore these aspects today in the conference through an interesting lineup of speakers and experts and leaders in the discussions that will ensue. Further, I'd like to emphasize that the need of proactiveness from India to embrace AI and machine learning investment is a crucial factor, and rapidly develop AI ecosystem that can globally compete in this digital era. Therefore, before I conclude, the technology industry in India, which I am part of, is in a truly exciting state now, unlike many other countries at this point in time. For more than two decades, the technology services industry was at the forefront of driving technology-enabled transformation of businesses across the world. But now, great initiatives like Digital India, combined with emerging technology, is not only transforming digitally, but leading global digital space as well, and building products. So the Indian industry is really moving from being a purely services way to becoming a product-oriented company, embedding all the latest technologies, which include AI, ML. With these words, may I now request and invite Lieutenant General Rajesh Pant to share his thoughts for today. Over to you, Dr. Pant, and very warm welcome to you again to this conference. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Prateek Garg. Am I audible?
Yes, you are. You are audible.
So you laid a very good base, and just to clarify, I am not using video so that my bandwidth is conserved and there's clarity in the voice. So I hope that is okay, because this conference is more about the content than, you know, seeing who's sitting where, and the mind, you know, tries to see what is that painting behind this gentleman. And, you know, we've all been doing a lot of VCs these days. So good morning to my fellow panelists, and good morning to all the other 120 friends who are viewing this on a subject which is very current and very relevant. And I must compliment CII for deciding on this aspect of demystifying responsible AI. Very recently, some of you may have observed that India has joined as a founding member, something called the Global Partnership on Artificial Intelligence, GPAI, it's pronounced as GPA. This is an initiative of over a dozen countries. The Five Eyes are there, that is the US, UK, Australia, New Zealand, Japan. And then most of the EU countries are there, Germany, Italy, etc., and Korea as well. And we are also one of the founding members. And it's the secretariat is by the OECD, that is the Organization for Economic Cooperation and Development, based in Paris. And there are going to be two development centers, Montreal and Paris. The aim of this alliance is basically to guide responsible development and use of artificial intelligence, which is grounded in human rights, inclusion, diversity, innovation, and economic growth. You see, some countries are feeling that AI is going to be a tool for increasing their national power. And we are aware of, you know, the news coming out from such countries as to how they will use the AI in the military and, you know, space and some other domains. But India being what it is for the last 5,000 years, our aim is totally for increasing the productivity, the national prosperity. So the first point, the Global Partnership for on Artificial Intelligence. The second point also, as this community would be aware, that there is a lot of discussion on the National AI Strategy of India. So this was launched by Niti Aayog in June 2018, and it has done the rounds of all the ministries, and Minister Ravi Shankar Prasad recently spoke about it also. There's a national portal also that he's launched, National Artificial Intelligence Portal, which basically brings together the ideas and resources in this field. It is something like what in my office we had launched a portal called TechSagar. Those of you who are keen can go to TechSagar, TechSagar.in, and see the 25 different technologies where the startups, the industry, the academia, the think tanks, everyone is brought together under one portal. So similar thing has been done for AI. And I am also a member of the steering committee for the National Mission on Cyber Physical Systems, where one of our verticals is artificial intelligence, and that vertical has also been launched. And for those who are unaware of this, it's a 4,000 crore program of the government, where we are identifying about 25 technology innovation hubs, as we call them, TIH, around which the spokes will be there for all the other institutes. And that is how the technology is going to grow. So that is as far as the National AI Strategy is concerned and the National Mission for Cyber Physical System is concerned. Now, artificial intelligence, as you're aware, excuse me, is coming in waves. You know, like the mobile phones come in generations, the AI is coming in waves. So we had the first wave and it was based on machine learning. And then the second wave was based on deep learning. Then there are some real world models that came up, and now is the fourth wave, as they say, of AI, where a lot of development is going to take place. The scope is also going to increase. My final point is that we must not forget that India is a very, very data rich nation. That is our brightest spot. 600 million internet users, 700 petabytes of data being crunched every day. And as I said in some other seminar also, that the variety of data that we have, and I gave the example of facial data, that for face recognition, you need a facial database for the AI algorithm to work. And in India, we find all types of facial parameters, you know, small eyes, big eyes, different types of hair, you know, large, small. So all those data points that you take and build into the database place, this is global data that we have in our country. So this is what people are after. So that is our brightest spot, and the treasure trove that we have is that we are a very data-rich nation. So this is these are the few topics I wanted to cover, and I'm glad Mr. Garg mentioned about the use cases which are being done in India. I am observing that there is a need for imaging of the cancer in a biobank, the Indian agriculture stack for the agri data flow is being handled. There's a national data and analytics portal. So a lot of things are happening, which will definitely drive the prosperity of India. And on that positive note, may I end, and as somebody said in the beginning, that there are some serious issues that we are grappling with. You are aware of the notification yesterday. Today we are busy in its implementation. So I may stay for some time, but do excuse me if I am not there after about 15-20 minutes. Thank you very much. Jai Hind.
Dr. Pan, very profound words there, and we do understand that you are in the midst of a massive policy change that the government is taking forward. And I think profound words there. We are a data-rich nation, and I love that. So with that, let me move to the next speaker. May I now invite Mr. Nitin Agarwal, partner Deloitte, to take us through the theme of today's conference and perhaps set the agenda for the rest of the conference today. Over to you, Nitin. Yeah.
Thank you, Mr. Garg. Thank you, Dr. Pant, you're talking about some of the initiatives Government of India is taking. It was very refreshing to see that we are playing an important role at the world stage, being part of this global partnership of AI forum, what you are talking about. And very refreshing to see that we have a national AI strategy, which is being driven by NITI Aayog. As Mr. Garg and Dr. Pant have already talked about, that AI is coming into the mainstream. We are seeing a lot of use cases, especially in the COVID situation. So I'm not going to talk much about the use cases perspective. I think we have seen a lot of AI interventions in the industry, the three industries we are going to focus on today, which are agriculture, manufacturing, and healthcare. So if you look at especially the healthcare, a lot of AI and data science are being used for discovery, development, and trials, etc. around the world. We have seen even in the agriculture also, some of the developed countries are using AI, in a concept called precision agriculture, where they're using technology to aid in the detecting diseases in the plant, pests, as well as identifying the poor plant nutrients on farms, etc. So I'm not going to talk about the use cases per se, but I wanted to amplify the responsible word here by talking or by sharing two or three, real life examples, especially in if you look at in last 3-5 years. So I will tell probably four examples. So first one is it was the pretty latest example last week. There was a story in New York Times where is a man in Michigan who was arrested for a crime which he did not commit. So what happened? This man visited a store, and the store camera, took his facial recognition, and then the law enforcement officers, they used this facial recognition software to find a culprit when there was a stealing in the same store, 6-8 months later, and found this guy, and there was some faulty recognition match in the software, and this man was arrested. And finally, the law enforcement officers realized their mistake and finally, apologized. But I think it's very concerning that how a technology led to a man being arrested in front of his family, and it has to undergo all those pains, for those 3 or 4 weeks. And this was last week. The another example I want to talk about, one of the very large top software company, product company, back in 2018, and this was a case in healthcare sector where their supercomputer was being positioned to kind of use cognitive technologies to eradicate cancer, and what was found after a year or so that a lot of the advices, lot of the treatment advice which was given by this supercomputer was not right. In fact, was very dangerous. And finally, this software was, the experts tried to do the research, and they found that the data which was used to train the software was more of a hypothetical cancer patient's data rather than the real patient data. So so they had to take it back, and in terms of the implications, etc. So that was another example wherein it was a lot of hype case that the supercomputer will treat the cancer, but found that we need to probably put more investment, more research before we kind of really roll out such kind of software. But I think in this case, people can argue saying, hey, it was not a real data it was trained upon. If you train on the real data, probably this situation won't occur. So another example. So this was a very large global company, and they were using this AI recruiting tool, and this was, I'm talking about back in 2015-16. They developed an AI recruitment tool, and they were using the technology to flip through the resumes, thousands of resumes, and based on the criteria you provide, the software will tell you the top 4 or 5 resumes. And it was working well. 1 year down the line, the company realized that the software was discriminating a particular gender people. So, the women which were not getting selected or shortlisted by the software were noticed by this company. And then they found out that the data which they used, and it was real data in this case, they used for last 10 years to identify, or to kind of shortlist the candidates, that data has a dominance of male applicants. And hence what the software did, it tried to kind of take that as one of the criteria and try to look at the words like, women's chess club captain, or, if somebody's graduated from women's college, and try to kind of, not pick those candidates. So this was an inclusion issue, right? And it was not there, nothing company did wrong or could do better, because it was the real data which company feeded. It was no algorithm which was coded to not to select women for those applicants, etc., right? So I think these are the real issues which really we need to take into consideration when we are deploying the AI. I mean, I wanted to quickly talk about one more example of this self-driving car. I mean, back, I think, March 2018 in Tampa, Arizona, when pedestrian was killed, and this autonomous car was being driven. It was, in fact, the human driver was also on the wheel. But company discovered that its self-driving software decided not to take any action after the car sensor, they detected the pedestrian. So there are, I think, these kind of examples where technology, has come a long way. But I think, we need to really, really make sure that when we deploy AI in our context, in our industry, in our firms, how do we deploy responsibly? So that's where I think I wanted to animate the responsible world here, which is the theme of today's conference. And especially this responsible theme is very important as Dr. Pant said, we are the data rich nation, right? We are sitting on 600 million internet users, and especially the theme like inclusion and diversity is so very important for countries like India. So I think that's the focus of the discussion today. With that, I will hand it over back to my next. I will hand it over back to Mr. Garg. Thank you.
With this, let me take the opportunity of welcoming Dr. Rajendra Kumar to this conference. Thank you, sir, for joining us. And may I now request you to share your thoughts on today's topic. Thank you. Over to you.
Yeah, can you hear me? I'm Rajendra Kumar here.
Yes, yes, we can hear you as well as see you. Thank you.
Okay, so thank you for inviting me, all my distinguished fellow speakers, all the participants. It's really good to virtually meet the fellow speakers and the participants in this event. If you really see the role that AI is playing, I will talk from the government's perspective because I mean, I have seen the potential of AI that we can really use in our government programs and in certain scientific services and in creating platforms that can be of use to both the stakeholders in the government as well as in the private sector. So let me begin by creating a bit of history in terms of how the journey for the technologies integration into government programs has been over the last 10 plus years now. So as many of you would be aware, we started with I mean a large scale national e-governance program way back in 2006, and since then there have been major efforts by both government departments and the state governments to mainstream technology in their own operations and also in delivering services to citizens. So from those days we have come a long way. Now we have the very large Digital India program, which was launched by the government in 2015 it was launched, but it was conceptualized in 2014. And now we are 5 years into its implementation. We have seen several major changes in the way government departments perceive technology, the way they use technology, and the way we deliver services to citizens. There is no denying the fact that in many departments, the citizen-centric services have been transformed through use of technology. And many departments have launched very large initiatives which are aimed at improving the lives of citizens and businesses through these electronic interfaces. In the last couple of years, we have also focused in a major way on the emerging technologies, of which AI is a key component. There is a large program now in my ministry currently, which is focusing on emerging technologies. And we have focused on AI in a very significant way to ensure that this can be mainstreamed in the work that we do and the work that various government departments are doing both at federal and state levels. So let me just give a few ways in which we are trying to really use AI in our own schemes and programs. After the launch of Digital India platform, currently work is underway with 10 main departments in Government of India, where we are building very large digital platforms, what we call them as the public digital platforms, where the effort is to really ensure that the programs can be delivered electronically through an integrated mechanism with a common platform to the extent feasible. And these platforms are being developed. And the idea is that we should leverage emerging technologies to the maximum extent possible. So we are building in platforms which can use, for example, IoT, then AI, big data analytics, and of course, ensuring security in all the operations. We also are running large programs to encourage startups in this domain. We have started a major program which we have named as METI Startup Hub. This was made operational last year, in the end of last year. And this program aims at encouraging innovation across the entire government ecosystem, across the entire spectrum. We have set up centers of excellence with the support of private sector entities, with support of NASSCOM, with support of our major academic institutions across the entire country, where they are incubating startups to bring innovation, develop prototypes and products which can be used by industry and by government agencies. So for example, we have a very large program in places like Bangalore and Gurugram, where the Center of Excellence are hosting many startups with very good initiatives in mainstreaming IoT and AI in industrial domain. So we have programs which aim at MSMEs, which encourage them to adopt Industry 4.0 in their operations processes and ensure that they can benefit from these technologies and become internationally competitive. We have had a major, we have had major success in this endeavor, I must say, and we would see the results in the time to come. Unfortunately, for the last four months now, we are we had to slow down because of the COVID pandemic. But this is only a temporary, setback. We definitely would like to see the initiatives coming back on their feet in the time to come, and making sure that we can really collaborate with the industry, with the other organizations, with academia, with government departments at the state level, to ensure that these programs can really be mainstream in their own work and in the way that they interact with their stakeholders. So I'm sure the events of this type which are being organized today, they would really help us, help the government departments, help the other stakeholders to get an idea of where we stand today and how we can benefit from these interventions. I must say that we need to collaborate more with the industry, with the other stakeholders, to ensure that the government departments can learn more about these technologies. I must admit that many departments are not aware of the potential of these technologies and how they can use it in their own operations. But just to give you an example for dealing with the pandemic, we have used these platforms in a large way for the last 4 months now to devise programs, to devise strategies, and really learn from what is happening around the world. In our own government domains, in government decision, we are using AI, for example, to find out the best treatments for dealing with COVID-19, to do drug discovery and drug repurposing, for example, and vaccine development. So these are the domains where we have tried in the last few months to really use these tools to ensure that we can really bring them to the benefit of the public as soon as possible. Going forward, let me say very specifically that this is the way we see that we need to move towards. Mainstreaming emerging technology is a key area for our growth. And we think that the government departments, they can really benefit from these technologies. You would be seeing large initiatives on our part in the coming months, where most of the government departments would get transformed using these technologies. We have already prepared design and blueprints for sectors like health. We are doing a lot of work in education, in agriculture, in logistics, in with the state governments. We are working very closely with them to ensure that this can be mainstream. In industry, MSME, also large efforts are ongoing from the government side to really learn how these technologies can be really used in their domains to improve their own operations and also to deliver better services to citizens and businesses. One of the key areas where we can really benefit from this is in terms of improving our ease of doing business for the industries and for businesses. That's one domain where we need to do more work, even though we have seen improvements in our international ranking in the last 5 years. But still, clearly, we still are number 63 internationally, not in top 50, not in top 25, or not in top 10. So that's where we need to move forward. And going forward, if we really aim at becoming among the world's best economies, then we need to use these tools more extensively in our own programs. Let me also say a few things about our vision for the next 5 years and where this can really take us. I think many of you may be aware that we have a vision to become a $5 trillion economy by 2024. And digital economy, we have targeted it to become $1 trillion by 2024-2025. So that's the target we have. So currently, if you see, the digital part of economy is about 7 to 8% of our GDP. We are about roughly $220 billion of $3 trillion size of the economy today. We wish to take it to $1 trillion out of $5 trillion. So which means that the proportion of digital in our economy has to go up from 7% currently to about 20% or more by in the next 5 years. So that's a huge transformation that we are aiming at. And we are very conscious of the scale of effort that is required. We think that this transformation to more than 20% of our GDP coming from digital is going to happen only when we are able to mainstream these technologies in our own work, in our programs, and in the way we interact with our stakeholders. So all the sectors of the economy have to get transformed, not just the digital per se, which has been main thinking till now, but all sectors, be it agriculture, health, education, logistics, or whatever, all MSME, Industry 4.0, all have to benefit from these technologies. And that's where our efforts are currently focused upon. I hope as soon as we get over this COVID-19 pandemic, these efforts would be more visible. We would be able to interact more, and we can see the impacts of these efforts all around us. So let me conclude here by saying that we are very conscious of the efforts that industry is putting in this domain, and we are on our part trying to play a catalytic role in ensuring that all the government sectors can benefit from it. So thank you very much, and I wish all the very best to this event. Thank you.
Mr. Gurbi, you are on mute. If you can unmute yourself.
Oh, yes. Sorry. So thank you very much, Dr. Rajendra Kumar. This was quite insightful, and it also gives us directionally where the government wants to take the digital economy and of course, ease of doing business is central to everybody perhaps on the conference today and the larger business community that we all belong to. So thanks for taking time out, and I really appreciate all your inputs here. May I now move over to Mr. Jagdish Mitra, who perhaps had some difficulty joining the conference earlier. Mr. Mitra is the Chief of Strategy and Growth at Tech Mahindra, and Tech Mahindra doesn't need any introduction. They are at the center of driving digital growth, not only for India, but also across the world. So may I now request Mr. Mitra to share his views on the conference today and enlighten us. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Garg, and thank you, Mr. Rajendra Kumar. Pleasure meeting you virtually this time. We've met a few times in your office, but good to see you. And yes, Mr. Garg, because a bit of I always say that technology companies have the biggest challenge in using technology. So I had the biggest challenge in logging to the conference today. But it's an interesting topic. It's an interesting topic that you bring together here. If others are not speaking, if they want to put your phones on mute. I think this whole discussion about responsible AI is a very interesting topic because, first of all, I'm not sure all of us have leveraged AI well enough and understood what it can be done. And at times, I believe we're probably one school of thought believes that we are trying to push the needle too way ahead of us and worried about things that are not around in the realm. We probably got to get data science and AI to work on doing some of the stuff that are fundamental to what AI has promised. And frankly, my belief is that AI's promise has not been delivered yet. I mean, an example of Tesla or an example of solving some problems in another business or an industry is really not where AI was intended to make a huge impact. And I, by no means am I saying that it doesn't have the potential. It still has. But, you know, its potential is as good as what it delivers. And we can't, you know, it's like one of those people that we always used to, when we used to follow cricket or sports, we used to have these talented people whom we used to be calling as, you know, he's extremely talented, but he's not making it to that level. So to me, I think AI needs to probably cut across some very large programs to make societal differences and impact. And then you can say AI has reached its potential or is reaching its potential. And in India, I think specifically, we have a huge opportunity. We have humongous, as I think Nitin mentioned, and I think Dr. Rajendra Kumar also mentioned, that there is the amount of data that we are generating here, and thanks to the government's programs and everything else that the businesses are doing, we are just creating the large amount of bank of data that will be the foremost important store for AI to work. But opportunity for us, whether it's in agriculture, whether it's in education, whether it's in health, the two or three things that fundamentally can differentiate our country and make sure our country is successful, is all opportunities for AI to be successful. So from our perspective, I think the focus needs to be more about allowing AI to be, for lack of a better term, my view would be that allow AI to be as much free hand as possible. Because only when you can break some rules and break some barriers in terms of what was the current process and what AI is telling us, it is when you will start to see what rules need to bring in. If you put the rules in the beginning, my belief is that you're going to curb innovation and you're going to stop people from trying to do new things. Rules in the new area like AI should come in little later rather than now. I'll give you an example why. And I think Nitin talked about this example where, you know, both in terms of, I guess there was something about the jail and he was incorrectly jailed in Michigan. And Michigan is obviously in discussion these days for a variety of reasons. I'll tell you the opposite of it. Okay. And the opportunity there lies in where AI actually could have used very, very effectively. There are about 500,000 cases in New York court that people got bails out of it. And that bail was given about 75% to 80% of those guys in terms of the hearings that were heard. And about, I'll tell you the number, it was about little over the 500,000, and 400,000 plus people were released. But about 40% of those guys failed to appear at the subsequent trials and were arrested for crime again. So that means the law and the human system actually failed in that sense to the society for this. And if you would have run the machine learning algorithm, which would have captured data, which have captured data about their movement, which would have captured data about their actions and their social media behavior, and so on and so forth, and probably captured the data shows that it could have detained more number of people and would have resulted in 25% fewer crimes. Now, this is what AI can do. And I think the opportunity for us allows, that's why my view is that allow people to do a lot more work around AI, let them experiment unbounded, and obviously make sure that we are able to figure out, therefore, the laws as we grow on. That doesn't mean that ethical AI or responsible AI is not needed. I think we need that absolutely. And I think as long as organizations and government follow a certain framework, we will be particularly okay in terms of ethical and governance and responsible AI being allowed. And I think there are a four-step process that responsible AI framework needs to follow. And the four-step processes are governance, design, monitoring, and reskilling. So, and reskilling is also related to the topic we are discussing here today, which is democratization. So I'll touch a little bit about each of these areas, and the World Economic Forum has done some work in this. Companies like ours, companies like Accenture has done a lot of work in this. Ethical AI is a big topic in this area, but my personal view is that it has to be today monitored at every organization and government level with these framework and allow people to innovate and within this framework and not sort of bound them by certain rules. Governance means when you start a project, do we know what is the governance of this project and is the AI data based on fairness and opportunity and transparency, as in the data being captured? Design, similarly, can we create and implement solutions that comply with the design that you have talked about for ethical standards? And each of these stuff that you're doing, each AI project that you're trying to launch out from a larger perspective of society, does it do that or is it biased? Similarly, monitoring. It's a key metric that you need to monitor, that what is the set of key metrics and what is the algorithmic accountability of this? And I think, is the algorithm primarily, and I think, again, some of us discussed what the software, some of the examples in a software product company, is where the algorithm had a bias and it started moving in that direction. And finally, I think it's reskilling. The democratization and understanding of our organization within AI today also is very, very, how should I put it? I think it's very high standards level, that you need a certain level of qualification in order to be able to leverage AI. And I think for us as technologists, our biggest role will be to simplify and demystify AI, and which basically means that usage of AI and usage of data becomes easier as possible, so that people can leverage the usage of data science for a particular set of solutions and not worry about running and knowing the most complex of programming languages. So I think that's my 4-point charter, Prateek, in terms of what could be the charter towards demystifying responsible AI. My view is that as I started, I think we probably need to allow a lot more innovation before we curve it. And that doesn't mean don't be responsible, but don't police it too much. You're going to stop innovation from happening. Thank you.
Thank you, Jagdisha. I think you summed it up very beautifully. This is a four-step to ethical AI, governance, design, monitoring, and scaling. I think that sets the a very good framework for where do we go from here. And of course, there should be no reason why we curb innovation. So thanks once again for your time and some great inputs that you laid out today. And with this, may I now move over to my colleague on the Regional Committee for AI, CIA's Regional Committee on AI, Mr. Vinod Sood, for his concluding remarks for this session, and also present the vote of thanks. Thank you.
Mr. Sood, you will have to unmute yourself. You are on mute. You're still on mute.
Yeah. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. We have had an extremely useful session. I'm sure that the participants would have definitely benefited from the seminar. I'm very thankful to all the speakers on the dais who shared their knowledge and talked about various aspects of AI and the use cases. Over the past decade, as developments in AI have picked up pace due to advancements in hardware and decreasing cost of computing resources, its application across various sectors has started gaining traction. Large technology players have rapidly moved into the AI space and have redesigned existing products as well as engineered new ones so as to embed AI within them, with the aim of catering to the diverse requirements of various industries. As we know, artificial intelligence has made inroads into the daily lives of Indian citizens without making it explicitly evident, right from the way we use app-based cab aggregators to digital assistants on our smartphones. The interest can be further gauged from the fact that leading IT services companies have begun thinking, talking, and a few even launching AI platforms. The systems being developed by them as of now are perfecting the process of increasing the efficiency of performing a repetitive problem, which eventually will snowball into solving ever-changing and complex problems. I would like to add that organizations are working across a plethora of AI problems, which encompass identifying patterns in objects, images, styles and preferences, to advise on retail shopping, building conversational services and use them over social media apps, and also use them for online shopping, better diagnostic services, bring in cognition in RPA and similar applications. The commercial applications of AI are massive, and Indian startups also are beginning to identify them and tap into the market, which till now has been nascent. As we all know, AI is being leveraged to address specific point solutions. However, as some of my fellow panelists also mentioned, the immense potential it holds can only be realized if the implementation is at enterprise level at scale. So while concluding, I would like to mention that we need a robust AI policy framework that needs to touch upon the social, economic, and ethical considerations of a well-governed society. These efforts will foster a balanced environment in India for innovation and leadership in AI. I also strongly believe that the national initiatives like Make in India, Skill India, and Digital India will immensely benefit from the developments in AI technology. With these words, I would like to thank our special guests, Sri Dr. Rajendra Kumar and Lieutenant General Dr. Rajesh Pant, for their insightful remarks on this subject. I would also like to thank my co-panelists, Prateek, Jagdish, and Nitin, for sharing their views and perspectives on artificial intelligence. My sincere thanks to the distinguished guests, participants, and sponsors. Thank you all for your virtual presence today. I now declare the culmination of this inaugural session of this conference. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Sood, and thank you all the panelists of the inaugural session. I think we had a wonderful discussion. So thanks to all the eminent personalities of the inaugural session. So with these, I think we'll start the next panel discussion, which is going to be chaired by Nitin from Deloitte. So over to you, Nitin. Maybe you can introduce the panel and then you can take over. Thank you.
Okay. Thanks, you. Guys. Thanks.
Sure. Thank you, Mr. Gao.
So yeah, thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Rajan.
Thank you.
So good afternoon again, everyone, and welcome to this panel discussion. We have eminent panel here. We have Manish Kumar Sinha, who is the Chief Marketing Officer from Sterlite Technology. We have Neeraj Athale. He's a Vice President and Head Customer Experience with SAP Indian Subcontinent. We have Amit Soni joining from US. He's a Executive Vice President and Chief Technology Officer with Matchlink. We have Dr. Avinanda Sarkar. He is Academic Director, Data Science and Machine Learning with the organization named Great Learning. We have Taranjeet Singh Bamra. He is the Chief Executive Officer with AG Next Technologies. And then finally, we have Dr. Masood Ikram, who is Managing Director with Melon AI. So just to set the context for this panel discussion, we heard from speakers earlier about your AI experiences and the risk associated. I think there were various views which were shared, while Mr. Goff said more power comes with more responsibility. And I really like when Dr. Pant said we are a data-rich nation, right? I mean, data is a new oil, data is a new currency. So I think it was feeling very privileged to have be part of a nation which is very data-rich. Dr. Rajendra Kumar talked about, you know, the government initiative. He painted a vision for next 5 years. And then I think a very interesting view from Jagdish, which is saying that allow AI a free hand as much as possible, otherwise invention will be cut in. So I think, you know, we have seen different examples that how AI is coming to the mainstream, but we also have a lot of examples where we saw the darker side of artificial intelligence itself. In this panel discussion, we would like to focus on some of the darker side of the AI, which I think we need to focus on to make AI more responsible. And again, I think Jagdish brought an important point that it should not be a limiting factor in terms of the adoption side. So it's a fairly balancing game between adoption as well as regulation, right? So wanted to start, and obviously today's focus is more on agriculture, manufacturing, and healthcare as a sector. So I would start, I would like to start with Taranji. So Taranji, question for you is that, you know, what is your view on AI adoption in a sector, especially like agriculture, which is seen as a conservative sector with, you know, less technology adoption, especially in country like India. What do you see the adoption of AI where, and what do you see, you know, the balancing game, what Jagdish was talking about between, you know, regulation versus invention? So your view, Jagdish, Taranjeet, to start with.
Taranjeet, you are on mute. If you can unmute yourself.
Oh, sorry. Can you hear me?
Yes, Taranjeet, yes.
Yeah, first of all, thank you very much, everyone, for inviting me to this prestigious event. You know, it's a great pleasure to have everyone over here discussing about, you know, artificial intelligence, and that too for a very important, you know, sector, agriculture, for the next few years. It's going to be extremely important for us to, you know, bring data sciences based decisions in agriculture. More so, as we have seen that post-COVID, the entire food supply chain network has seen disruption, and now more and more efficiency needs to be brought in. That can only happen if we can take decisions quickly in the whole value chain. And sadly, what has been happening for, you know, a lot of decades till now was that the decisions are very intuitive or subjective. And whether it is a farmer, you know, taking a decision what to sow and when to sow, to, you know, what exactly it is going to, you know, reap for a better harvest, or it's going to about, you know, going to selling it in the market, and the buyer also deciding what is the, you know, price that it should give to the farmer. This entire thing, which was now dependent on subjectivity, will have to be removed using data sciences. What we have seen over the last 4-5 years is lot of entrepreneurs and lot of youngsters coming with, you know, ways and means to understand the problem in the whole agri value chain and kind of creating new innovative solutions for solving this. I'll give you a few examples. For example, there are a lot of startups working in the field of satellite database analysis of, you know, large swaths of land. How does that help? It definitely helps to understand, you know, where exactly what is growing. That really helps us to, you know, optimize our production systems. For a government, it is very important to, you know, understand where what is growing. Usually, what are the problems in India is that, you know, if somebody grows a certain area, the other common area catchment also kind of starts growing that. And that leads to a lot of, you know, disruptions in supply side becoming very large and demand not existing for these farmers, and ultimately they have to grow. What you exactly see is, you know, tomato being thrown on the roads, or, you know, potato being not being taken, people selling it at, you know, giving money to take them away from the fields. These are the issues that, you know, crop up if we are not using data sciences along with artificial intelligence to analyze, you know, what where can grow. So the bigger part is about, not about the, you know, the data sciences, but it's about the data. And that is what the startups have been actually solving, that how do we extract data out of, you know, this entire big value chain from a rural network to a tier two city to a, you know, to an urban area. And that is what has been the effort of a lot of the startups to focus on one sector and keep start focusing on data collection. For example, the satellite industry, the satellite startups are focusing only on startups and then kind of linking it to, you know, a big basket or a Amazon to tell them, hey, do you know that this is the area under catchment and how much quantity you want, whether it is going good or not, we would like you to connect with them. So this is just one example. There are other, you know, app-based solutions, data that people have gotten into to, you know, match the price and the demand for various commodities. And a lot of companies, startups, which are in the app segment are using this along with forecast of weather, along with forecast of, you know, what is the overall demand pattern in the last 3-4 years to, you know, give a right advice to the farmer and the buyer in terms of, you know, what is the price point that needs to be undertaken for agriculture. But the bigger ones that as Agnex, for example, we have been focusing, we are fortunate enough to be awarded as top 5 in Asia and also showcased at Silicon Valley. What we had been focusing on is a total new, you know, set of hardware that can extract data in the agriculture value chain. For example, we are using computer vision with AI to instantly analyze $2 billion worth of tea leaves that are bought in India. And I'm just talking about in India, $2 billion worth of tea leaves are bought with subjective assessment. Somebody just taking it in the hand, spreading it and telling, you know, I will pay you this much. Imagine the impact if you're bringing objectivity and kind of helping the farmer as well as the company with the right pricing by using computer vision and artificial intelligence. And this is just one example. Wherever there is a, you know, intersection of buying and selling, the application of artificial intelligence based data sciences is so huge in agriculture that it's just unfathomable. It's you know, I was when I came to India in 2016 to start this company, you know, I was just literally swarmed with ideas, you know, what we should do in, whether we should do the pre-harvest side or the post-harvest side. And what we when we started focusing on only one aspect, which is the buyer-seller intersection, that is so deep for, you know, artificial intelligence to conquer and help both the buyers and the sellers, that we are just finding incomprehensible, you know, horizons. It's just so huge. I just told about tea leaves being 2 billion. That's too just in India. We're talking about, you know, tea leaves in Kenya, Sri Lanka, all across. And then we are talking about coffee. We are talking about, you know, cocoa. All of these are like, you know, multi-billion dollar markets waiting for, you know, buying through AI-based estimations. Similarly, we have worked on a total new hardware, which is spectroscopes, which can, you know, analyze using light the quality of, you know, or the chemical constituent of a material. You just kind of scan it and it will tell you, you know, how much protein, how much fiber, fat or constituent is there. Especially in the COVID times when the agriculture value chain is disrupted and nobody, you know, was there at the warehouses to buy. Our technology is seeing a surge in demand like anything. literally all of the companies who are in the procurement, they want to talk to us to, you know, understand how quality they can be estimated and the right pricing can be done using AI-based technologies. So we are seeing huge demand in protein estimation, which is exactly the entire meat industry, which is a multi-billion dollar company industry, for example. And they want to do the estimations of quality of protein, et cetera, fat, et cetera, of, you know, all the meat that they're processing. Similarly, we are talking about milk. We are the only company in the world which can do instant analysis of milk along with contamination. And adulteration is a big, big issue in the food value chain, which AI can solve very, very strongly. We are talking about adulteration in spices, adulteration in milk, adulteration in alcohol. You know, a friend of mine always used to say that jitni Jack Daniel duniya mein banti hai, usse zyada to UP mein bikti hai. You know, that's true. This is where AI for food systems is so important to solve, you know, the post-COVID world. Thankfully, I was a director with KPMG in Europe and Middle East before I came to start this. We started just at the right time, I believe, because the COVID was waiting maybe. But the idea is that we just see that there is so much to do in food and agri, you know, value chains using artificial intelligence that we are just kind of scratching the surface. We are just solving for quality right now, but we see that, you know, blockchain is coming for quality assurance along with the right set of AI tools and for sure trade along with, you know, our platform. So I think it's just a start, and I'm also in the committee. There's a Niti Aayog committee which we are presenting to the PMO for a full digital stack for agriculture. So I am in that committee where an, you know, very, very eminent corporates like Amul's chairman is there, ITC chairman is there, and a few startups like us are there. We are working on a full digital stack across the pre-harvest and the post-harvest value chain to showcase to the government that, you know, how we can collect data and build AI for solving a lot of decision-making in the value chain. Thanks. So I think it's just a start. Yeah.
Thanks, Saranjit. I think this is very helpful and talking about some of the art of possible, right, especially in the sector like agriculture. So I'll come back to you later in terms of what are the roadblocks you see in the countries like us. But hold that thought for now, and I will move to quickly to Dr. Masood Ikram. Dr. Masood, I know that
Mr. Minister has also joined.
Sorry, who just joined? So,
Mani Sinha.
I'll continue. So Dr. Ikram, right? We heard the story about adoption of AI from agriculture perspective. Let's shift the gear towards the healthcare now. I know that technology has been, healthcare sector has been probably early adopter from technology perspective. And, you know, people are talking a lot about AI and technology, especially in the COVID-19 context, right? And people are saying machine believers. So where do you see, and we saw the example of that cancer, you know, use of the technology in solving the cancer issues earlier, which didn't want to be true. So what is your take about, where we are from adoption perspective of AI in a healthcare, and what are the roadblocks or problems you see from reliability aspect of it? Over to you.
Yeah, thanks, Nitin. That's a good summer up you give so far. And Taranjit gave a very good insight about how agriculture is also doing more into this. Irrespective of the timing, whether the timing is good, bad, or COVID, and all, it has to be discussed. And we are discussing it rightly. And it is motivating every time you discuss about AI, because the future of certain disease or certain situation, AI is going to be a part of it. So where is AI to us today? So I'll put you in a very small understanding how AI is today is, you buy Alexa, you buy Google Home today, and you ask for a particular respective song. And if the Alexa doesn't able to pick up the song what you're asking, and then you don't get disappointed, you try again, asking again. No, I didn't ask. I asked that one. And if it still doesn't understand, you modify your question and you try to ask it again. This is what we do every time when we don't get it rightly. Even for Google Maps, sometimes you ask for a particular destination, it might not show it right, but you don't doesn't discourage you to do it again properly the next time. So this is what is AI to you today. So we are motivated guys to do something better in AI. So we take responsibility in constructing it, the AI better. So our generation today take responsibility that we have to build AI together properly. Probably we might be the guinea pigs who are doing trial and error to make this AI better for the future. But nevertheless, we have the opportunity today either to build the AI in the respective way we are looking in for. So let's take this opportunity in the generation where we are and take the advantage on how to build the AI and take it forward. This is about how we could narrate what AI is today in the current scenario. We have been working on AI with a lot of different products in our own company. We have a larger product, we have a smaller product, there are different projects which we are working on in our different company. To give you, help you understand how AI to the people who are listening to us, a small application which we have built, a very small application, we give you a very fair example than how AI is helping in healthcare also, apart from other bigger ideas what we have. We built a very small application called Farebill. A Farebill is a simple thing like, when somebody goes to a hospital taking the father or a mother or somebody else in the family, and you go and tell the admission counter that, we need admission for this particular surgery or disease or this particular whatever you require in there. The admission counter gives you a price, says that iska 2 lakh hoga, iska 5 lakh hoga, whatever it gives you. And at the time of discharge, we all know what happens. It is not 2 lakh what they committed. It's something more than that, or even more, double the what they've been offered to you. What actually happens there is, it's not the hospital to be blamed. They don't want to raise you low and take you high out of them. The scenario is very different there. They're not able to give you a right pricing because it varies from different to different factors. It varies from doctor to doctor, it varies from ward to ward, it varies from patient to patient, comorbid, no comorbid, for diabetic, for non-diabetic, for insulin, whatever. There are multiple reasons adds up, extension of the stay goes up, and they're not able to give you the right price. So what we have done here is a very small application for all the hospital here. We're calling it Farebill. You take last 3 months of your data, this particular patient, this particular surgery, this particular comorbid situation, diabetic, hypertension, what was the price? So and so, what was the price? You start collecting data of 3 months, upload the entire data, whatever you have, ask the machine learning to learn the pattern, what is available in the particular data, which is responding to your hospital. After you upload the data, you can delete the data also because the machine has already learned the data. Now a new patient walks inside the same hospital and asks, I want to get admitted my mother here, and I want to do a knee replacement surgery here, and what could be the cost? Then this admission guy who doesn't have to use his mind, he just have to use his application, put the data there, and a particular price comes out with the range. It's somewhere around 2.5 lakhs to 2.5 lakhs, somewhere, whatever the price comes out. Then this particular price, when we're trying to work out in our testing department, we were able to get this pricing at 92% accuracy. So this 92% accuracy makes this particular hospital to go up in their customer value. No hassle, nothing. They're able to plan the discharge better. Everything is better. This is one of the examples of what we have done. This is why I took this example, is because it's a simple way to explain it. We have got discharge summary. Other places we have even tried to replace the doctor, but not 100%, but we are trying to help the doctor. Ultimately, AI today cannot replace anything here. What we can do here is complement the situation, augment the situation, and support the doctors who are currently there. So this is what AI in healthcare is about, and bringing to your recent kind of situation, the data what we are getting it from the government, the number of positive cases everywhere, we were able to analyze who is the more prone for death, who is more prone for yes, who can be admitted, who doesn't have to be admitted, which particular geography is behaving better, what is happening geography. So demographic study is doing a lot of help in today's thing. And of course, the CT scan images, because since it is a very new disease which has come, and we don't know the pattern of this particular disease growing. So actually, if you ask a doctor, it will say it is the disease is growing from central to middle. This is what we call it, central to middle in a CT of a lungs.
You don't have to get into all that. Just take a picture of that particular CT scan. AI will say, yes, it is a COVID or it is a non-COVID situation. So this is helping in that way. A lot of AI situation thing has come inside, which is might not be helpful 100%, but yes, it is giving a very good idea how to take it about and to take it forward. And AI and this telemedicine is also being a bigger generation part today. And then what had not happened to telemedicine for the last 10 years has happened in the last 3 months. And AI is complementing the telemedicine as well. So it's overall a very good win-win situation when it comes to healthcare and AI. We're hoping a lot more to be coming in, a lot more data to be getting inside it. To you, Nitin, do you have anything more?
Yeah. So thank you so much, Dr. Ikram. I think it's very helpful. I mean, in terms of what you talked about, some of the data usage, I'll come back to you on the data sensitivity aspect of it, data privacy issues aspect of it. And what is the data, what you're using for some of your data science algorithm, etc. What if the data itself gets corrupted? So I'll come back to you on that thought. I will move now to Dr. Abhinanda Sarkar. And Dr. Sarkar, question for you. I mean, I know that you have been working in data science and machine learning space for a long time. What are the challenges you see in AI deployment and where are you in terms of the point what was raised by Jagdish earlier that should AI given pre-hand versus, you try to regulate a little bit to start with. Where are you on that? And I think another question I wanted to kind of put you is around, the explainability aspect of AI, because most of the AI application what we develop are the black boxes for own developers. So what are your thoughts on some of these aspects?
Okay, sure. Am I audible and visible?
Yes.
Thank you. Pleasure to be here as always. And my you and my fellow panelists have set this up wonderfully for us. I represent Great Learning at this point in time. We've been delivering training programs all over the world, 150 plus courses, more than 20 million hours. And we're seeing a lot of interest in AI and data sciences. That is where most of our growth is coming from. That is where I do most of my teaching in. And it's been an interesting time for all these areas for a couple of reasons. One, before I get back to addressing the specific questions you raised, is on the democratization point that has been made, that is becoming increasingly easier to deploy AI. It's becoming easier to simply take a solution that exists in the cloud, a solution on image analytics, a solution on text, and to be able to build a service out of it. To create such a solution, of course, needs a lot of effort, but to be able to put it into a runtime environment for someone to use it, a marketing company to do sensitivity sentiment analysis, or for an agricultural company to look at images and forecast crop yields. All of these probably are becoming easier without necessarily having to know a lot of in-depth technical knowledge of building neural networks or doing natural language processing. So that's driving a lot of the growth in data sciences and AI. That's driving a lot of the research initiatives as well. Because what it has meant is that the people who are leading the research and development initiative in AI and data sciences aren't necessarily computer scientists or mathematicians or statisticians. They could be from healthcare, they could be from business, they could be from law, they could be from a variety of domains. So this kind of breadth that the field is seeing is partly due to the fact that the way we are teaching it and the way the solutions are being deployed. Now that's led to a problem, which comes to the other point that you raised, in that how do we manage this, shall we say, black boxy nature of the beast? A couple of examples of perhaps the dangers that are out there, and you've seen many of them, won't belabor the point. About 10 years ago, we had a flash crash in the market, where essentially in one day, some May 2010 or thereabouts, the market crashed by about 9%, about $1 trillion in valuation in the US. It lasted about 36 or thereabouts minutes. But the reason it happened is primarily because of apparently some action by rogue traders, and then computers deciding that enough is enough, our circuit breakers have kicked in and we're going to do nothing and let the market crash. Now, computers were doing exactly what they were trained to do, And it took humans, very clever humans, about half an hour to figure out that this is not where we need to let computers loose. Let's get our money back while we still have to have anything in our deposits. And so things weren't necessarily at their best at that time. So you'd say that's 10 years ago, and you know, we've come a long way since then. Well, about last year, 2018-19, we had these Boeing 737 incidents. So we had a wonderful system that was on an aircraft. The pilot's flying the plane, and the aircraft decides through an MCAS system, where A stands for augmentation, is to augment the pilot, wants to prevent the aircraft from going into stall. So it keeps pushing the nose down. And the pilot is there saying, no, please let me get up, please let me get up, please, you know, let me fly the plane. And the computer is repeatedly saying, I'm trying to help you, I'm trying to help you, I'm trying to do what all pilots want to do. So it's a system built with great care, great consideration, great intelligence in order to make the plane fly the pilot wants it to fly. And the problem apparently was that the pilot wasn't told about. And the pilot wasn't essentially made aware of the fact that there is a super intelligent system in your plane that's supposed to help you. It would really have helped the pilot to know that there's this guy, clever computer, that's out there to help. So I think that we're living in an interesting world where, even setting aside the more futuristic things, that when we get on a plane, we're being managed by AI, our deposits are being managed by AI, and we don't fully understand it. The argument, of course, could be made that you don't need to understand it. Maybe the pilot needs to understand a little bit, but the passenger doesn't. He's fine so long as he or she gets there. Or maybe the banking system needs to understand it. RBI needs to understand what circuit breakers are. But maybe me as a poor depositor, I don't need to understand it. So the fact remains that how do we figure out among common professionals what it is that needs in AI that needs to be demystified, and what it is that we need to understand more of and therefore do it better? I think the jury is still out on that in our training programs. What we are trying to do is to teach it in a way that makes sure that the boundaries are relatively okay. What that means is be clear about the data that you're putting in. Make sure that that everyone knows that this is the kind of data that's there, these are the variables, and this is what I've done to it. On the other side, to do it in such a way so that the runtime environment is very explainable and understandable, so that you know what it is that you're supposed to do in order to get this to work in the way you think. Now, this has helped in a very practical way for us. It's enhanced our learner base hugely, because if we can make AI and data science about understanding the data and understanding the output, that's very, very good. But it has also, like in Flash Crashes or in Boeing 737, created a little black hole around it where we don't quite know how to trust and what to go about doing it. I'm confident that we'll get there. I'm confident that we will understand these intelligent systems in a way that we understood regression of a decade ago, or of, say, you know, when I was in college. So we will get there. But in the process, we live our lives, you know, through disease, on planes, and in accounts. And so these are interesting times coming. On the upskilling side, we are doing our bit, and my fellow panelists are doing it in wonderful industries. As we understand nature more, we'll build the theory, we'll build the training, we'll build the analytics so that we can do this kind of safely and hope for the best.
Thank you so much, Dr. Sarkar. Very interesting perspective. And I think I really like the way you said, you know, this two-legged approach, that first you decide your boundaries and then you create those runtime environment scenarios, right? So I'll move on to Mr. Manish Kumar Sinha. Manish, what do you see, you know, work with a company, Sterlite, which is kind of working a lot of cutting edge technology work, right? What do you see typical risk in terms of you know, implementing some of the AIs in the right way? And especially I wanted to touch upon the inclusive part of it. I think a lot of speakers talked about you know, we need to make sure that AI is inclusive, especially in a country like ours. What's your thought on that topic?
Oh, thanks, Nitin. I think a very important question, and very, very good perspectives from Saranjit and Drs. Masood and Dr. Abhinanda Sarkar. I think extremely interesting perspective with all the stories you shared. I do think that there are two questions about AI that I feel that are pertinent today. One is how can it help us? And second is how can it not destroy us? I think a lot of our focus sometimes goes to the second question. You know, because it almost is in a perverse way demonstrating our faith in AI, which is not actually being shown by the current AI's capability. We believe that AI will become so big, so strong, that at some point it will destroy us. And I think that is in a very weird way an acceptance of the fact that AI will actually add a lot of value to us before it gets to that point. You know, we think the singularity is near, and you know, one day AI will become sentient and start doing things. And you know, I've seen movies like Her where a man actually falls in love with AI, and I do think that these are fundamentally the space of science fiction. What Dr. Sarkar was talking about is live and here, and I do think that that we can actually see a lot of benefit from it. So first thing I would say is, what is the benefit we are seeing today? So at STL, which is Starlight Technologies Limited, we actually are setting up digital networks for the richest, where you are going to actually get started with 5G networks and fiber to the home and all the high-end bandwidth stuff. And also for the most upcoming part of our society, which is with BharatNet, we are setting up networks in the remotest villages of Maharashtra, of Telangana, and right in the middle with cities like Kakinada and Gandhinagar, we are setting up city-level network management, right? And I think we are seeing at a very subtle level some amazing use cases of AI. And I would want to actually bring ourselves to today. So today, if you were driving with three people on a motorcycle, well, you know, hopefully you're not doing that with lockdown time, but suppose you were doing that in Gandhinagar or Kakinada, right? A cop doesn't have to see you. There's a nice little camera that will do two jobs. One is it will actually see a picture of your scooter. Notice that there are three people on it, not allowed. They don't have a helmet, not allowed. And here is the registration plate of that scooter. It'll go identify from this picture that and actually go to its database and figure out who is the owner of that scooter and send them a nice little fine automatically, right? I mean, this is where we are today with AI. And I think that's fabulous because, you know, you can't go around and talk to the camera and say, bhai, please take this 200 rupees or rafa dafa karte hain, right? So I think that that is where we are with AI, and it's helping us be more disciplined. There is another example, I think, Taranjeev was talking about AI in rural, and it's amazing what AI is actually able to do in rural. We have a tool that we called STL GURB, which is actually a data center for villages, right? And what we do is we set up on a village, and that village has to be the village that is actually on BharatNet, otherwise how would you actually get data? Well, it's kind of an edge data center, if you think. And it's actually doing some AI processing there and trying to throw most of it to the center, and we have four or five such implementations, not too much. It's just the beginning, and I would love to know from Dr. Sarkar what he thinks about this. But there are implementations of little sensors in certain farmers' fields about moisture content and you know, things like whether certain plants are getting the right amount of you know, on the ground implementation of best practices. Plus, there are sensors that are out there with air moisture, light, number of hours of rain that has been happening, what is the pollution level, and all of that is being fed in there. And farmers are being given some simple guidance that was, you know, hey, you need to water your field, right? Or, oh man, you're doing too much, hold on, right? And it's happening in very small cases right now. Now, look at the power if we take that on-ground data, and what Taran was talking about was from satellite imagery, right? And merge that too. And you start telling the farmer, you know, things that can save their lives, because, you know, otherwise these guys are sitting with humongous debt. And it's just better management of their daily life that can change that. So I think, you know, this AI thing of, you know, Lucy, who is going to have this little dangerous hand, and they'll kind of, the big brother is watching everyone, is nice for science fiction. Today we are in a spot where we can all just use AI with good networks and make some amazing simple life problems solved. One last example I'll give you is what actually AI helped us do in Kakinada when a storm was coming. I'm sure you remember last year we had a cyclone that hit on the east coast of India. This year we had one that was about to hit the west coast. It did, and it thankfully didn't cause the kind of damage we had last year. But last year a cyclone was hitting. There was a major AI collaboration between the meteorological department and the smart city of Kakinada. What was happening is they were getting all this data, and with a network that had billboards and announcement systems and all, they were automatically suggesting to people, get out of here, don't do this, this area is dangerous, da 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 da. And all of this was being done to manage the disaster management. Not a very humongous cool case of AI, but what is cooler, that you can actually identify a cat from a dog, or you can save 20 lakh lives because they knew well in advance that a dangerous cyclone is coming. I would prefer to save lives first. And today I think I feel very proud that our technical community is focusing on the use cases of AI that can save lives, that can help improve things. Whereas the researchers, I don't know if you guys, anyone follows here, I am not paid by this guy, but I think he does a great AI blog called 2 Minute Papers. Dr. Sarkar, you should absolutely follow it with what you are talking about. He takes all these beautiful papers and gives you a 2 minute view, and you can see how fake videos are being done by AI, how faces are being recreated, how AI is now drawing pictures like Van Gogh and Monet together. So there's some fabulous use cases coming in the future. You know, AI is even able to make music and concertos, and I'm very, very looking forward to that time when AI will do all this cool stuff. I'm not looking forward to the time when I have to have an AI girlfriend. No, my wife will kill me before that in any case, by the way. But I'm looking forward to that time, but I'm very, very happy that today in our villages, we are helping farmers with farming. In our cities, we are helping people, saving them from cyclones. And, the crime rate is the first thing that AI can actually help drop, right? You don't have to read number plates. You can actually let AI do it. So that's my viewpoint. It's not just about healthcare. It's not just about the rich people. It's not about the fancy things that are going to come in the future or Boston Dynamics. It's about making our daily lives today better. And that's what we feel that, and STL and my company is actually focusing on that. And, I feel that our country is actually doing the use cases that it needs rather than copying the world's use cases. Like, we do not think that it's important to do driverless cars in India right now, right? I mean, I think there are other things that are more important. So I feel very proud that we are focusing on the right thing. So that's what my point of view is. Hopefully, interesting story for you as well.
Sure.
And for everyone's ideas here, very, very, very interesting to hear all of them.
Sure, Manish. I think a very important aspect of it, I think two things if I want to marry together, right? As Dr. Pan said, that we are the data-rich nation, so we have the data, and we are using the data to uplift the life of the common man and the sectors like, agriculture, what we just talked about, and enforcing the law, right, in our country, which is just very encouraging. So I think this is we were also talking about Dr. Rajesh Kumar was talking about the vision for next 5 years, and how India will play a very important role on the world stage, right? These are the things that obviously will contribute to it, that how we can lift the life of the common man. Now I will quickly go to Mr. Amit Soni. I know that it must be pretty late for you, Amit, in the US. I know which part of the US you are from. It's on the East Coast, it's probably at midnight or maybe after midnight, right? What's your take, on AI from deployment roadblock perspective, as well as, I think you have seen some of the developed markets that how AI is being used. I mean, Manish brought a very important point that we are not focusing AI on developing the autonomous cars, but rather we are helping our farmers to use AI. What's your take, working in developed markets in like US, where a lot of investment is happening in this technology, and What are the lessons learned for countries like India to take away from countries in the markets?
Thank you, Nitin, for the opportunity, and thanks to all the speakers and participants. Amazing session, a lot of, I would say, education for me today. I want to start, Manish, with, first of all, you asked me, I'm from Michigan, East Coast, and you brought up Michigan a couple of times in this session. So that reminded me of a story, and also it correlates with what we are discussing today. So let me start with that. So in 1899, more than 100 years ago, Michigan is an automotive town. A gentleman created a car that is called Horsey Horseless. And the purpose, the car looked like an artificial horse attached to a real car. And the purpose of that car was to not to frighten horses on the road. So, and I see very similar concern we have now, that we are frightened about technology, but eventually it will be there, it will become part of our life and not really bother people or people see from suspicion. And you asked pretty good point. So let me, I would rather AI, when it becomes again too centric, and it's also one of the most used or abused word today in industry. So if I take a step back and step aside, and I think I can answer the question in three dimensions here. One is the adoption part is primarily driven by availability of data, right? And which is also an important part to control AI being used effectively. So I'll take an example of European GDPR, which is General Data Protection Regulation, which is similarly adopted by US. And I learned about India, which is called India Personal Data Protection Act, which was approved by Mr. Modi's government. And I'm not sure if it is implemented or not, but it's being implemented. So the blood and life soul of any AI would be, again, data. If no data, no AI. Now, better. So the having a responsible data will generate responsible AI. So that's number one. Second thing I see that there are, I heard some of the interesting use cases today from different industries today. So I strongly believe there should be a playbook of how to use AI ethically for different consortium, and it should not be generalized. Right? Having a traceability of having a right material for supply chain versus having a traceability on medical in healthcare is two different ball games. So consortium should take lead on creating those guidelines. Again, not enforcing it, but create those guidelines, because enforcement will certainly reduce the innovation. And finally, as a IT practitioner, I see the biggest responsibility lies with IT companies. And again, within IT's company, I see two aspects there. One is companies who are developing transactional systems, which is where the data is being created, and the AI product and services / BI companies where they're consuming this data. So first, for transactional companies, from ERP and CRM systems to any homegrown solutions on that line, they have to work extra hard to create the traceability of information, which primarily means who created the information, where it's coming from, where it is maintained, how it's, so that is a lot of times not maintained. It creates doubt about information, and it creates doubt about your AI. And when it comes to AI product companies or services companies, this is where I strongly believe we need to educate our users, more than users, the actually developers of the AI solutions. So once they get hold of data, they feel super empowered, right? That, okay, I have the whole data and I can do whatever with it. But that is the education that we need to provide. Number one is that, what is the business around that data, example, right? And when you are creating an insight through an AI, who will consume it and how it will be applied? Is it ethical? Is it unethical? And finally, at the end of the day, whatever AI would do, it will help you with decision making. Either you automate it or manually. And how does these decisions influence individuals' life? Right? And if I really look at a system, which is we try to do here at Luminor, which is create a cause and effect system, that what insights produce what results, and what data was utilized for it. it's easy to say, but very hard to implement. That way, if you can fine tune your insights, or you can fine tune your data and fine tune your decision, it will eventually deliver certain result that will be in this context, the result should be ethical and pretty much legal in nature. So that's the context. As far as the adoption goes, my lesson learned is we as a IT practitioner bother our consumers with a lot of buzzwords and tell them more than they need to know, and also show them a lot of information which is hardly understood. So people talk about dashboards and pretty much pretty charts. Most users do not understand what to do with that. So to improve the adoption, what we are doing here is we're simplifying it by pushing the insights instead of user pulling it. So if the machine is using an algorithm, machine is generating insight, can we narrate it in a simple English or simple Hindi and push it to an individual in the context of what they're doing? So it has to be in context, number one, to good adoption. And also it should be as simple as possible and use their terminology, how they consume within their business. And finally, it has to create efficiency for the company. It has to monetize their data. It has to generate ROI for the company. But at the end of the day, I would say simplification is the key. And eventually people are moving, will move away from dashboards to more push insights, which we have a word here at Luminal we use called anti-dashboard. So which probably means that you still have dashboard, but we start with simplification of information. So that's my input for now.
Thank you so much, Amit. This is very helpful. I think I really like the way you said, the two side of, the data creation and data consumer, right? And how they need to kind of work together to create the right data, which will create responsible data, which will create the responsible AI. So very good. I think I will move on to Neeraj. Neeraj, I know that you have been waiting with a lot of patience. Tell me your view around, and I think with you, I wanted to touch upon a little bit on human way, right? That how we can create AI which can be more trusted as a fiduciary, right? Who can act in the best interest of their clients, right? What's your view? What you see from adoption risk perspective? Your thoughts, Neeraj?
Right. Yeah, I think so. From an SAP perspective, we get an opportunity to meet multiple industries, a lot of customers across the board. And what we are seeing in this area, or the area in which the largest consumption of AI is happening, is in the area of customer experience, in various shape, forms, fits. So if you look at the Hyderabad company where you essentially have a great experience like Ramoji. So, Ramoji City is where you pay, go in and, experience those various Bollywood sets, and you get a chance to see those magicians and all of that. So the business model of Ramoji City is all about selling an experience. The same is with a Disney, if you go to a Disney World. But if you look at our customers in the real estate industry, in CPG, foods, or fashion, or retail industry, banking, insurance, telecom, they are trying very hard to give an extraordinary experience to the customers. And in that context, one of the trend that we are seeing in some of the leading organizations is how you can actually, philosophically they say, if you love somebody, you set him free. So the same philosophy is being adopted by some of the leading companies, where they say that if you really love your customers, then set them free and let them have the freedom to choose you, let them have the freedom to explore you, and let them have a freedom to engage with you. And AI plays a significant role in this model. The ability to not become a pain for a customer, but to actually enable him to succeed, is a completely different ballgame. And when you really look at how some of the customers are trying to achieve this, I mean, if you look at the relationship between a husband and a wife, typically it is based on, trust is kind of the most important factor. The second most important element is that the relationship grows over a period of time. And third is you can't force a relationship on anyone, whether it is a friend, a girlfriend, or a wife. The same logic is with customers. You have to build trust with a customer. And that trust is built on how you are not using their data in a way that they don't know about. How can you make sure that you take their permissions before you use that? How can you make sure that at 2 o'clock midnight, if the customer says, I want to remove my profile from your portal, and I don't want you to ever touch me from now on with any email or even with your associated companies to touch me. That flexibility needs to be given to an end customer. And whether it is GDPR, which is trying to enforce that, and I'm sure that's doing a great job, but leading companies are ensuring that they give this freedom to the end customer and build that trust. Secondly, if you look at how some of these large corporations are trying to lead by, as I said, giving them the freedom to interact. Now, the moment you give the freedom to interact with a customer, you are not telling the customer that I'll come to you. You are telling the customer that I will reach out to you when you need me. Yeah. And that's a very important element. So to understand a customer, you need a significant amount of AI, ML capabilities in your applications. And that allows you to understand the customer better. The moment you understand him better, you are able to cater to his needs in a much better format. So if he's come on your portal, if he's come to your call center, if he's WhatsApping with you, whether it's your chatbot that's talking to him, you should know who the customer is. You should know what he's already bought from you. You should know whether he's raised a ticket in the past. You should know whether he's, you know, a B2B or a B2C customer, so on and so forth, you know. So understanding is critical. The moment you understand him, you can engage better, because now you're assisting the customer. You're not pushing him. You're assisting him. That's where the difference is. So when you engage, you basically change the game big time. And third most important is, once you help him engage, he explores you as a brand. He explores your product and services much more than what you would have pushed onto him. And then finally, you give him the freedom to choose. And the moment you give him the freedom to choose, your responsibility using these new technologies like AI, ML is to deliver the most efficient way, to deliver in the most speedy way with the best quality, so on and so forth. Now, if I accumulate this entire concept of giving the customer the freedom to engage with you rather than you going on to him, it pushes AI in 8 or 9 different areas. AI in the area of marketing can be used, can be abused. AI in the area of sales. Now, with COVID coming in, the ability to track where the sales guys can actually go or not go based on the red zones and other things, that's again an interesting case study that we see. Most of the beats, as they call it, for FMCG companies is nowadays a function of how COVID is spreading or contained. So in the area of sales, we are seeing a lot of AI come in. In the area of sales performance management, I mean, with COVID coming in, the whole incentive and commission schemes are changing. Whether it is a trade promotion for a dealer, distributor, retailer, or it is commissions for a sales guy, the whole model is changing. And there's a huge amount of AI that is built into how a certain commission is being applicable and the performance is being calculated. Just 2 or 3 last points. In the area of what we call customer cloud, you know, so customer cloud is where you give the customer an option to engage. You give the customer the ability to choose whether I can use your email ID, I can use your phone number, I can contact you. Can I contact you through Twitter or through Facebook or through WhatsApp or through what? All these are permissions that the customer is giving you, and your ability to store them and transparently show it back, saying, here is what you allowed me to do and I'm adhering to it, and you have the flexibility to change it whenever you want. You know, so that's important. And again, not the last, but one of the interesting areas we are seeing is whether I'm delivering pizzas, whether I'm delivering biscuits or refrigerators, or I'm fixing air conditioners or transformers. What we are seeing is a huge amount of AI being implemented in training and learning. You know, with migrant labor moving out, many of the companies are not getting drivers, they are not getting delivery people, they are not getting service engineers. So there was anyways a massive churn in this kind of a process. But with COVID, the churn has tripled. And that results in a drop sudden in customer satisfaction because your front face is not tuned. So AI in training and learning is coming up in a very big way. Identifying what are the weak spots. So So whether the delivery guy is not dressed well, he didn't follow the COVID requirements well, he didn't sanitize his hands before delivering the pizza. You know, touch points where you get data and then you implement that in the form of AI. Yeah. So I just kind of give you a gist of what I'm seeing in the market. Happy to answer any specific questions or give more information on this domain. Yeah. Thank you. Thank you.
Thanks, Neeraj. I think you basically put there, you know, the trust philosophy around, you know, understand better, engage better, and keep the freedom. You know, so I think very beautifully put there. So I think in the interest of time, I have so many follow-up questions for this team panel, but I think we are close to 7 or 8 minutes before the close. I want to take one or two questions from the participants as well. There's a one question came from Khushbu Chapla for Manish. And the question is that, you know, you have rightly put forward to use AI solving real-time problems. But her question is for industrial sector, looking at recent incidents in our industrial segment from gas leakages to boiler blasts and explosion of reactors in pharma. How do you see AI solving these issues in much prescribed manner and just in a predictive way? It's time that Indian industry sector adopts AI to improve lines of employee contract levels, labor, etc., and avoid these high-profile, high-cost penalties and the competition. So before I hand it over to maybe Manish and Dr. Sarkar too, but I quickly wanted to talk to you, Khushbu, on that. You know, you talked about this contract labor laws, etc. So in fact, we had worked with some of our clients and automated some of the compliance part of it. So, you know, from automation perspective. So if you want, we can share more information around that solution. But Mr. Sarkar, I would talk to you first. You know, give 30 seconds your answer, then Manish, you can react to it. I think Dr. Sarkar, you are on mute.
All right, I'm back now, I think. So very quickly, the point well taken. When we talk about this kinds of technologies, we talk about descriptive version, a predictive version, a prescriptive version. So the predictive version is dedicated to saying, what do you want to predict? You want to predict sales, you want to predict amount of disease taken care of. The question relates to the prescriptive version. And prescriptive version usually is based on what it is that you want to do well. So when you're prescribing something, when we build an AI solution in prescriptive format, we say that this is what I want to prescribe it to doing. Say, for example, I want to identify the best customers. I want to prescribe an action that will get to next best offer. Or I will prescribe a treatment that saves the patient. So for prescriptive, in my opinion, the way to solve some of these issues is to make sure that the object that you're trying to make best, that you're training the AI algorithm to work best, is very well defined. And if there are ethical issues and there are legal issues around that, then tell the algorithm that that is something that you should not do. If there are labor law restrictions on the amount that you need to pay, then bake that condition into the algorithm. If there's data that you cannot use, let's say genetic information on a patient, then bake that into the algorithm. The algorithm is not clever, but when we make it prescriptive, if we make our constraints consistent with what the social, political, legal boundaries around it are, then we are better off. This is hard to do, very hard to do, because I think, as Amit said, those who have data simply want to give you a good result. This is what the data says. But if you put good boundaries around what you are optimizing and what you are prescribing, some of these can be taken care of.
Very important. I think data from the factory, from the industrial environment is very important. We are actually seeing two fundamental reasons why it can be done. And so I don't know if the lady who's asking, Khushbu, I guess, has an understanding of how one has to actually do it in factories, inside a factory, and then is outside factory. They're very differently done. And the beauty is that because of industrial use cases being data driven even before the advent of AI, history of data of many, many types are available. So it is learning can be done much faster for AI there. But the problem is that the issue is about capturing data at the inception point instantaneously. And a lot of this would mean that many factories would need to actually be enabled with sensors of IoT and robotic responses. It's not just AI, it's actually data capture and stimulus response devices that are very important. So while AI would do today a very good job of predicting if all the data was given to it, and maybe many cases the data is also available to AI, AI is half there if it can't actually go back and control the valve and switch things off and have a robotic type of input back there. So overall, this, I think, you know, taking the hazardous chemical world in account, it's actually AI plus IoT plus robotics. You bring those three together, that's when it happens. And it is even more difficult when you're talking about hazard management outside the factory. Like I talked about the case for, you know, disaster management in a city. There, it is actually goes a little bit further, and it has to actually create enough messages for humans to listen. Inside a factory, you have well-defined protocols. People listen, right? You can say, this area is off, the door is shutting, you've got 24 seconds to get out, and people will get out. But when you are doing it at the city level, nobody listens that way. So it needs a lot more psychological AI, which I think is an upcoming field. So very valid question. And I also think that the world is actually moving towards so much production that, you know, it's just impossible that all of this can be done by humans. So robotics plus AI plus IoT sensors. And I think once CII did a session on this about how that would mean that we will have to move to IPv6, because with billions of devices and sensors on IP, the current IP approach will not work. And that transition is happening. So I see Industry 4.0 is already happening in many countries. Our country is starting to do it. It's something that we just all need to do. It's possible technically. Thank you.
Thanks, Manish. So I think, you know, Amit, you also mentioned about, you know, the data traceability and data. You know, I think in manufacturing sector, the data quality is a huge issue, right? I mean, the data itself has an issue, but the data quality is a issue, right? Any thoughts on that? I think we are quickly approaching to our close time, but 30 seconds, please.
So I think it's where it starts. So as the more cloud solutions are coming into picture, it's making data availability and consumption much easier. A lot of legacy systems, so information was hand-typed, right? So if you look at from supply chain primarily to transportation and anything around it, it's a lot of hand-typed information. So the AI is not able to really assist us. However, as they're using RFID-based technology in collecting data from plant floors as well as during transportation, AI will be much more effective and is being effective now because it's directly consuming data from the source and it's clean data. So it's a slow change, but it's evolving now.
Thank you so much. I think we are towards the closer of our time. I mean, thank you, everyone. I mean, we can continue to go on for next, you know, a whole day. Especially, I have a lot of questions for you, Taranjeet and Dr. Ikram, especially in the sectors you are working on. But I think we are top of our time. And, you know, I think all the participants, thank you so much for your time as well in joining us for this panel discussion. I mean all the panels contact details could be circulated if they are not already, and feel free to reach out if you have any subsequent questions. So feel free to reach out to these panel members. Just to summarize, I think very interesting point of views we heard from different speakers earlier and through this panel discussion from panelists. Just to summarize, AI is, getting more and more mainstream. There are very exciting use cases in country like us, especially around penetrate further, to the areas where our country was not able to. We are a data-rich nation. We are using some of these technologies to uplift the life of the common people. But at the same time, there are certain, rule book or I think playbook, as Amit was talking about, needs to be developed. It could be industry specific. It could be, where the data is being generated versus data is being consumed to make sure that the responsible data is contributing to develop the responsible AI. There are, there are initiatives what government has taken to kind of come up with new initiatives, vision, and also putting the regulatory framework. But I think, you know, my view is that, we don't need to constrain too much, you know, from rules and regulations perspective. There should be an attempt to make sure that there are certain systemic risks of what AI brings to the table or the data brings to the table. How do we protect, around those data and the systemic risk, right, to start with? And again, we don't need to be perfect on day one, but at least some effort, some thought process need to be initiated without, restricting AI from use cases perspective. So with that, thank you once again, everyone, to participate in today's discussion. And I'm handing over back to Mr. Garg for any final comments.
Thank you, Anand.
Thanks so much.
Thank you very much. On behalf of CII, I would like to thank all the panelists for such a wonderful session. And Mr. Prateek Garg is also here. Mr. Garg, you would like to add something and give a word of thanks to all the speakers.
Oh, yes, absolutely. I was not planning to be here, but this session was so enriching. I must thank each and every one of the panelists for really making this conference successful. A plethora of ideas and so many use cases, and the future of AI does look very, very promising, and perhaps is going to be mainstream. So thank you, and thank you for all of you, the participants, for joining in and sparing the time too. And we at CII have been really very happy to have brought this very enriching conference to you. Thank you once again.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you, everyone. Good meeting you all. Take care.
Thank you. Thank you, everybody.